So let's go ahead and get started. A little mention of Studio 300. We are open during these times. We're open by appointment only. We love to see it. We have all of the same things that we normally would have, our computers and our audio booths and our incredible equipment collection. Everything is available to you. We are open by appointment. You can give us a call. You can send us an email and set up an appointment for whatever you need to do. If you haven't taken our online orientation yet, that's something we debuted just a couple of months ago. So instead of coming in and taking the orientation course that we require, it's an online course. You can just take it anytime, 24/7. You got to pass a few quizzes. Once you get the answers correct, we'll get you all set up and ready to use Studio 300. But what can you do when you're not in Studio 300? And that's kind of the whole point of tonight's class, is we have an amazing equipment collection, we have amazing software, we have amazing computers, and an even more amazing staff that can help you. But if you're looking to do some of the things in another way, maybe outside of our normal hours or when you have other work, a Chromebook or the Chrome browser will really open up a world of opportunities for you. So you need a Chromebook to get started on the things that we're working tonight, or really just the Chrome browser on a PC or Mac computer. So I'm on a Mac computer right now, and I'm just using the Chrome browser. But all of the things we'll show tonight will work very well on a Chromebook, that's the whole idea, or on the Chrome browser. And many of these things are just web-based apps. Some of them may require creating an account in order to use them. Most of the things I'm gonna show you are either free or they're free with limited functionality, something like Canva, where most of the things work for free, but certain things you can pay for. There are a few items here that have watermarking. So in order to get rid of the watermarking, you'd have to pay for that. And then some are just free trials that you can just experiment and see if it's something that you're interested in. But all you need is Chrome, and really just any Chromebook will work really, really well. We've tested these on even just really basic models like the school district has, up to some really, really nice models. And I'm mentioning that because we actually have new Chromebooks in the library as a whole. So if you're ever in the library and you need a laptop, you need a Chromebook, you can actually check them out at all the public service desks and you can use them within the library. And we just got a new round of brand new, fantastic models that just blew me away in terms of the feature set that's in them. So take advantage of this. Now, when I actually started this Chromebook in Studio 300, I originally developed it for the middle and high schoolers in our school district, Valley View School District. And so in order to get to this web page that has all the resources I'm gonna talk about tonight, you need to follow this link. And so bit.ly is actually just a URL shortener. And then if you can remember, VVSD for Valley View School District, and then Studio 300, and it is uppercase VVSD, that address, that web address will take you to the website I'm gonna show you in just a moment, that I keep updated with what I think are some of the best Chromebook apps. Now, it doesn't have every Chromebook apps, and now that Chromebook also does Android apps, I certainly don't have all that information. But the original idea was this would work on a really basic Chromebook, like the ones our school district uses for all of their students. So we tested these with the school district laptops, school district Chromebooks, to make sure everything worked. So again, if you have any questions at any time, go ahead and type them into the Q&A. I'll be happy to take them as I chat down into the corner there, take a quick peek down there. So bit.ly/VVSD300 will take you to this webpage, which I've titled Studio 300 on your Chromebook. And this webpage is just chock full of links to all kinds of media creation software, helpful videos, all kinds of different things, category and desktop publishing, photography, some keyboard shortcuts, things that are useful within the Chrome system itself, music production, podcasting, photo editing, 3D design, digital storytelling, video coding, project management, and more. Essentially, all the things that you would be doing in Studio 300, I have compiled this together to make it really easy. And everything's a link. So if you can just go to this website here, which I keep updated, and follow the links, and we'll go through a whole bunch of these here. There's a few more pages also up here, specifically for the educational people. Google puts out an amazing amount of material on the Chromebook and the Chromebook things related to that, like the schoolroom, all those things. If that's your particular interest, you can follow this link, and it's constantly updated. It's just amazing. If you're not a real shortcut user, I would definitely suggest that you learn a few. It can make life much easier. And many of these shortcuts actually go across different operating systems. So whether you're on a PC or a Mac or a Chromebook, a lot of these will be the same. So it really can save you a lot of time to ultimately learn a few shortcuts, even just a few. The best way to learn them, in my opinion, is to take a Post-it note and put that new shortcut on that Post-it note and stick it on your computer monitor or stick it on your Chromebook, and then just continue to use it over and over again till you don't need the Post-it again. Throw that Post-it away and then start in on a new shortcut. I also mentioned most Chromebooks, newer Chromebooks, will allow you to use Android apps. You can actually go to the Google Play Store and install those on your Chromebook. This won't work on the school one, so I always have just added this as something for people who are running their own Chromebooks, and also if you have an open Chromebook that way. How to do that is here. I'm not really going to talk about that one tonight, but just know that that is something you can add. So if you have certain, if you have an Android phone, you have certain apps that you like to use, you can actually add those to your Chromebook. Back to the main page here. I would be remiss if I didn't start with all of the wonderful e-resources that are available at the Fountaindale Public Library, of course. And the main one is really just the main e-resources page. And when you click that link, this will take you to our amazing e-resources page. And it doesn't look like a lot, but when you open up these beautiful little carrots, you'll see the wide variety of resources that are available. And these may be websites, these may be particularly apps as well, just a terrific amount of things. So let's say you're actually interested in ancestry, interested in doing genealogy, you can actually have that access. Originally, Ancestry was only available inside the library itself. So if you were inside the library with your Chromebook, you could get it. But now you can get it from anywhere right now. And that's a temporary thing. So if that's something you're interested in, definitely take advantage of that. I won't go into the details here. I'll leave this for you to explore. But there are tons of resources. I think whenever I have shown this to a patron who wasn't familiar with this, they always walked away saying, I had no idea you had that many things. We have a tremendous amount of resources that you get to with your Chromebook, with the Chrome browser. And that's one of them. Back to the page there too as well. If you don't have a library card, you can also go and find out the information that you need for getting your library card, where our district boundaries are, and all of the steps you need to take that. We'll leave that again to your own. I do have a tremendous amount of tabs open here. Let me go back here. And just hit a couple of ones that I think are actually very, very helpful. First is the BrainFuse. It's actually a suite of a lot of different little resources available through BrainFuse. And again, I originally built this for the middle schooler and high schoolers. So I always like to point out the homework help that is available for the young ones. So if there's anybody out there with that, you have live tutoring. So you can actually click that link. Let's say you got a history report due tomorrow and you need some help. You can click that and get help from a live tutor who can send you in the right direction and help you out that way. There's also tools for adult learners as well. As we let that go together, there is Citizens Prep, there's help on Microsoft Office, so if that's something that you need to use. And this is one of my favorite, as well as the Writing Lab. So if you're like working on a resume or a cover letter or something like that, you can actually go into the Writing Lab and submit that and get help and some guidance on those things. So I recommend that one. Also related to the BrainFuse is the Jobs Now, or Job Now rather, I always say that wrong. There is resume help there, job interview helps, and other career guidance that's available on that. So you can get to that too as well from our e-resources page. Now, when I work, sometimes I like to listen to music. So one of my favorite tools is using Hoopla, and we'll head on over into Hoopla. And Hoopla is more than just music, it's movies, it's TV shows, it's audiobooks, it's ebooks, all of those things are available. But let's say I'm in a, how about a Marvin Gaye kind of mood here. Let's go ahead and search that one. And that will bring up a variety of different music from Marvin Gaye there, as you can see. And I'm gonna go into this one here. And all I gotta do is I can just borrow it. So as soon as I borrow the title, I'm gonna have it for 7 days. It's just that simple. And then I can go in and start playing the music that I wanna play too as well. We'll see if that's actually gonna play for you. Right on. And behind you. And you can have that playing in the background, have Hoopla open, and you can do other work on your Chromebook at the same time. So that's one of the other resources I recommend too. If movies are more your thing, I like to always mention Canopy. Canopy is our streaming service where you can just log in with your library card and access all kinds of movies. If you have something like a Roku device or a smart TV, you can actually add this Canopy app to those Roku devices and smart TVs. And then you can actually just log in your account one time and you can access these movies and watch them. And you get, I believe it's 10, and I should know this, I believe 10 titles a month. It might be more than that. And I apologize if it is more than that, but it's at least 10 every month and you can watch any of these movies. So there's Canopy for you there. Head back here. If you've got some other learning that you want to do too as well, two of my favorite are Gale Courses and lynda.com. Let's head on over to Gale Courses here. And there are a ton of these courses available. And these are actually 6-week courses. And they actually just opened today with the next session. So the session goes for 6 weeks. This instructor-led, self-paced, so you go in on your own time and take the course, but there's an instructor there to guide you through everything. So if you have a particular interest, let's say you're interested in Photoshop, we'll go ahead and search for that. And you'll see all the different courses that are available. Here's an introduction to Photoshop. And you can see it just started on the 16th. The next section would start on October 14th, just to give an idea. It says 24 hours. That just means the course is available 24 hours. Basically, the way all these courses work is they open up 2 lessons every week, one on Wednesday and one on Friday. And then you should see a quiz at the end of those 2 lessons. And so you can just work through the different elements. And there's video and there's reading and there's other little projects that you can do as well. There's forums, so you can meet with other learners really from around the world who may be taking the same course. We do a variety of what we call learning circles in Studio 300, and we build those learning circles around these courses. So all the patrons take the course together and then meet and regularly discuss it, which I think works really well for adult learners to be able to meet and discuss the things that they're working on. So there's a ton of things here, as you can see just here in the sidebar that you can search for. So definitely go and explore that. In order to enroll in the course, you will need, of course, your Fountaindale Library card and PIN. If you're looking for more kind of sit back, I guess, is best way to explain lynda.com. You like watching videos and you want to be able to learn a lot of things, your library card will open up all of lynda.com for you, which is an amazing resource. So let's say you want to search for things on your Chromebook here. So let me type in Chrome. And let's see what we get. I've not actually typed this into Lynda, so I have no idea what it's going to kick back. And there we go, learning Chrome Web Developer, learning the Chrome browser. So let's just kind of go into learning the Chrome browser here. And this will show us a whole course that's available. And it's a variety of different videos. And rather than be just like one giant long video, it's actually broken up into really logical segments. So what I like about that, if you don't want to do the entire course, like maybe you know the really basics, but you really wanted to know like how to download files, you can actually just jump right to that video, watch it, and get the information that you need. So joining lynda.com, you use your Fountaindale library card to create an account. And what's nice about having the account is, it's a free account, it's included with your library card, it'll keep track of what you've done and what you haven't done. And I think that's really useful. So definitely explore that. So that's just some of the Fountaindale ones. Let's move into some other specific ones we can look at. We're actually doing a series of classes here for the Valley View. And we did one the other night just for a Chromebook for Valley View parents. So parents would get an idea of maybe what their students are doing. So I posted that video here. We'll be doing another one next, which is actually called Customizing the Chrome Browser, kind of an adjunct to what we're doing right here. And I highly recommend that. And I will put that video here too as well when that's available, but you can also sign up for the class too as well. So what about all those web-based apps and all those other websites and things that I mentioned? Let's take a peek at them, and we're gonna start out with writing. Writing is near and dear to me, so I put it at the top of the list. I think it's important. And here's a couple of my favorite things. I'm not gonna go into every single one of these, but I'll just kind of touch on the ones that I think are really good. Let's say you don't like typing, or maybe you just wanna try something a little different. Well, SpeechNote is a speech to text tool. So let me click on over to that. This is what it looks like. It just runs in the Chrome browser on the Chromebook. And you do have to turn on the microphone, and I'm hoping that this will work here, but with the Zoom running at the same time, we'll see what happens there. So we'll allow that to work. It did start to work, very nice. Period. So, comma, let's start by showing you how SpeechNote works, period. You simply speak and it types on screen, exclamation point. Isn't that amazing? Question mark. You do need to learn to speak your punctuation, comma, which is kind of odd at first, comma, but you get used to it, period. New paragraph. So the secret really to this, I better turn off my microphone, is speaking, you know, in a fairly slow, basic way. And you don't have to quite do all of that punctuation that I was doing there. But if you speak slow and deliberately, and if you're in a relatively quiet space to begin with, if you're in a really crowded restaurant, it's probably not going to work really well. But if you're in a quiet space to begin with, it gets pretty good. And we'll look there that it did miss one word, which was probably me speaking too fast. But it's a really neat way to work. And I know a lot of writers actually talk about doing dictation because they can often speak faster than they can type. And it's something to experiment with if you've never done it. Definitely try it here with the speech notes link. And then all you gotta do is select the text when you're done. And you can just copy it and paste it into a word processor and do other work with it. So that's one of my all-time favorites. I really like speech note and I really recommend that to you. Let's cut back here as well. I always like to mention some of the writing programs out here. The Young Writers Program, which is part of NaNoWriMo. Definitely for that, let's go ahead and click on out to NaNoWriMo. And NaNoWriMo is, of course, National Novel Writing Month, which takes place every November, where the idea is to take the 30 days of November and write a novel, to write a novel in a month. And they define a novel as being 50,000 words. So you write 1,667 words every day, and you'll have a good first draft of the novel. There's all kinds of writing tools here as well. You don't even really have to be a part of NaNoWriMo to use a lot of the tools and resources that are available. And the Young Writers Program as an adjunct to that is very, very helpful there too as well. I like to mention dictionary.com and thesaurus.com. Very, very handy when you're working on your projects, any kind of writing project. But I actually like this OneLook one, which I think is a really, really amazing thesaurus. It's a little bit more sophisticated. So let's try something like flower. And it will give us all kinds of different lists and everything. And we can just look at flower nouns. We can look at adjectives, we can look at verbs, we can look at adverbs that are related to that. We can look at all of them. And then these are all links. So you can just kind of continue to move on in until you find exactly the word that you want, like precocious. So I really like this. It's one of my favorite thesauruses. I do a lot of writing and I really enjoy that thesaurus. Let's close ourselves a few tabs here. We'll close the main one, whatever we do. All right, there we go. If you're looking to another type of program where you can actually do the writing and also be able to output an ebook, let's say you want to publish something on Amazon or Barnes & Noble or something like that, I would highly recommend Pressbooks Public, which is a really neat piece of software. I'm not going to log into it right now, but you can actually create the ebook and make a print-ready formats right in there. So if you actually have something already done, maybe in Microsoft Word or another program, you can actually copy it into Pressbooks and it will output an ebook for you for free. Very, very nice. And that's available through inky.org, which is run by a regional library system known as Rails. So not only on inky.org can you write books, there's also a ton of books that you can check out too as well. We have a similar thing here at Fountaindale Public Library. So many of the books that you see here on Inky will already be on Fountaindale, just so you know. ApolloPad, I want to mention that. There's a very nice piece of novel writing software known as Scrivener. And unfortunately, Scrivener does not run on the Chromebook and it does not run in a Chrome browser. It actually only runs on Macs and PCs. I really like the program a lot. And I looked around for something that's very similar to it on the web. And there are a bunch of them, but they're all what I'd say a little pricey. And some of them are, you know, $10, $12 a month, which doesn't sound very much, but over time it actually costs a lot of money when you really, really think about it. And Scrivener as a product is actually only about $40 one time and you never have to pay any more for it. But this little piece of program here called ApolloPad, it's very much so like Scrivener. Right now it's in a free beta, so at some point it is going to cost some money, but I always feel if you want to experiment with it, this is the time to do it. So going to ApolloPad, it allows you to work in a very Scrivener way, and that means you're kind of working on individual scenes, individual parts, and then you kind of, the software kind of stitches things back together. So it's nice because you can outline in this, you can put things on post-it notes and put them on a kind of a pretend bulletin board as you see here and move things around. So if you decide suddenly that chapter one really needs to be chapter five, you can just kind of grab it and move them around and you can add to it. This is a really sophisticated program, really, really clever. Check of how much you've written, and so you can set up goals for yourself. So if you are doing something like NaNoWriMo and you need to write 50,000 words, it'll tell you where you're at on any given day. A really neat piece of program. Again, it's in a free beta right now, and it works very well, even though it's a beta program. It's actually been in a beta for a while, and so definitely something you might want to check out on that one. And that's my writing ones. Any questions? Again, use the Q&A. Please stop me anytime. I'm happy to answer them as we move along here. Moving on to desktop design and publishing. We've got a wonderful bunch of tools at Studio 300, not only Apple's Pages, but also InDesign and Illustrator and Photoshop. But actually one of my favorites, and I use it all the time, even though I have access to those other tools at Studio 300, is to use Canva. And if you've never used Canva before, you're in for quite a treat. So let me pop over to that. Canva allows you to design really just about anything. And it's a free program to use. There are some elements to pay for, usually a lot of the artwork that is within the program. So my advice to you is don't use that artwork and then you don't have to pay for it. There's a lot of free stuff and you can also bring in outside artwork too as well. So let's design, let's go out here and just design a quick book cover since we were just talking about novels. So everything is template based here. So it starts out blank, but you can see there's a whole bunch of different templates that you can choose from. And so you can just kind of spy through them and find something that you like. So I kind of like this don't go there kind of thing. And we just click on that template and it automatically goes in there and everything is editable. So you can go in and edit the title. So let's say, let's go outside. Let's call it that. Don't go outside. Let's make that capital E there. That'll look nice. Notice in this background here, so I've got a picture here in the background, but it has these little lines going through it. And that just is telling me that that picture actually costs money and I would have to pay in order to use that image. So instead, I'm going to go and find another image myself. So I'm going to actually upload an image that I downloaded. So I'm just going to drag it from my desktop in. That should pop in and take a moment for that to upload. And I'll tell you where I got this free image, and it's a pretty slick one. Not too long ago. While that's loading, I'll go ahead and type another name in here. Need a nom de plume. But you can design flyers in this. You can do a Facebook posts, Instagram posts, all of those things. You can make cards, letters, newsletters, all of those kinds of things like that are available to do in Canva. And it will output images that you need. It will output PDFs, anything like that. If I'd have known that image was going to take that long to upload, I would have chose a different image. So I apologize for that. I guess it was a little bit bigger than I thought. And I'm going to just kind of drag it in here. Come on, there we go. And so there I'm able to swap out my image that I downloaded. Move that so you can see the scary image that I have there. And so now I'm not paying for that because I got that image at another site and I'm done with my book here, just for instance. And so I can just go ahead and download it, choose the format that I want to download it in, PNG, JPEG, PDF, and I'm ready to go. It's really easy. I really like working in Canva. I use it a lot for some web graphics and I commend it to you. So right from your Chromebook, you can be working in a really sophisticated design program. And as you can see, Instagram, Facebook posts, posters, flyers, all those things, logo design, presentations too, which is fairly new, Facebook cover images and more. And they even have these animated ones that have a little bit of motion and fun for adding to your Facebook page or that. So definitely take a peek at that. There's another one called Poster My Wall, which is very similar to Canva. So I'm not really gonna go into great detail with that. But it's very similar where you're choosing from a variety of different templates, customizing them, and then outputting them as well. So if you don't really like Canvas much, or sometimes you can just get inspired, I may just go to a site like this and see something that's inspiring and might use it and recreate it in another program, or I might do it in the program itself. So that's another one to do. If you're doing a little bit more sophisticated desktop design, I would recommend LucidPress. Now, LucidPress does have some free tools and then it costs for a few more. So it's not going to be for everybody. But again, it's kind of template based. And you can go out there and start with the template and add the information that you want to it. So it works a little bit more like a typical desktop publishing where everything is inside of its own little container, and you can flow text in between these containers and move them around. So you can actually get a little bit more sophisticated. It's really a terrific tool. Again, it's fairly limited in the free version, but it might be all that you need. And then you can upgrade if you need to, if you even want to at that. But that's Lucid Press. And those are all on the list there. Canva, Lucid Press, Poster My Wall. Are all on there. Let's switch out here to Draw.io here. So if you need to do any kind of flow charting, this actually plugs right into Google Drive here. I'm gonna save my diagram out to the device, and I'm gonna create a new diagram. And they have a bunch of different templates also to start with. So let's just go with a basic flow chart here just to show you. And we'll go ahead and create that one up real fast. I think this one makes me laugh because it's a very basic flow chart. Oh, I gotta give it a name. I think Untitled is a good name. Let's put it out on my desktop so I can find it later. And there is a very, very basic flow chart. And you can grab and move these things all around. You can add other elements as you need. Whatever it is that you need to do, you can type and change the words. All available to you, and then output those. And this will save actually right to Google Drive if you're using Google on your Chromebook, which you would on your Chromebook or on the Chrome browser. You can download them to other formats. I just saved it locally there. So if you need to do any flow charting. All right, that's my desktop publishing. Let's go through and close a few of these things out here. My, oh my, slowly but surely starting to get fewer tabs here. Kind of related to desktop design is where you can get a whole bunch of free artwork that's out in the world. And I don't think there's any place better actually than Unsplash. And so when we go out into Unsplash, you can search for just amazing photography. Let's go with sunflowers. Why not? And you can see all of these. And if there's one that you like, you can actually just click on it and then you can download it for free. You don't have to do anything special. You are certainly allowed to attribute who it goes, and they'll give you the language for that if you want to do attribution, and I recommend doing that for the photographers that do all this, but you don't have to. You can change them in any way. The only thing you can't do is resell the picture on its own, but you could bring that into a book, turn it into a book cover or something like that, report cover, anything like that, and it will work for you. One of the neat things about Unsplash, which is why I like to recommend it, not only does it have some amazing photography, some of the best really, I think, that's available, is it actually plugs into Google Slides. So let's go out into Google Slides here, which I used at the beginning. Let me actually open this up here. And this is known as an add-on. And if you go within any of the Google apps, so whether you're using Google Docs or whether you're using Slides, which is what I'm using right here, you can actually search the web store for a variety of add-ons. And you would do that by just going to get add-ons, and you can search for these. Now I've already added Unsplash because I really like to use it. So I'm just going to turn that on so you can kind of see what that looks like. That actually opens Unsplash directly inside Google Slides. And so now I can go and search for the exact same thing that I just searched for on the webs. And there it is. Hey, those pictures look familiar, don't they? And if I find the one that I like, I can just click on it and it will actually put it right into my Google Slide presentation. Let me move that to the back there. And you can see that I did indeed insert a stunning picture here. So I love this. I mean, just amazing. And you can certainly resize to any of the things that you would normally do inside Google Slides. And that's just searching for the add-ons. If we go back there, how to do that is actually right here on the web page that I gave you earlier, and that'll show you exactly how to do those add-ons. Another website you can look at is morgfile.com. I always like to call it, this is where stock photos go to die, hence Morgfile. So just another one, same kind of rules as Unsplash. You can use them in any way that you want with no worries. You don't have to do anything. So let me close a bunch more of these here. There we go. All right. Move on to there. Archive.org is another one. There's more than photos there. If you've never been to archive.org, just an amazing things there. Oh, and I forgot to mention the noun projects a lot. Let me actually go back into here and open up, which is another add-on for Chromebook. And this is all just different icons. And they have a lot of really basic ones that are free, and then there's a whole bunch of ones to pay for. But if you just need some really basic icons for something you might be doing, the slideshow or anything like that, you can actually just click on it. You can actually recolor it really fast, which I think is really nice. And then just go ahead and it'll automatically insert that icon. And that's a scalable one. It's what we call a vector graphic. So you can make it bigger or smaller without it getting any quality difference. So that's the Noun project. So that's up there as well too. Quick hits there. If you ever need to do some screen capturing or any kind of screencasting from your Chromebook, hitting the control and what's known as the window switcher key, which looks like a bunch of little windows, that will actually take a screenshot of your full screen one. And if you hold the control and shift on the switcher key, it'll actually be able to do a partial one. And that'll save locally on the Chromebook, and then you can use that. So if you're doing any kind of training or you need to do some screenshot, that's the way to do it. If you need to actually capture everything that you're doing in a video, I would recommend using Screencastify. And when you launch that one up, it'll actually ask for permission to save to your Google Drive, and it will actually save everything. So it works out really well. You can just turn on Screencastify. It'll record your voice. It'll record whatever's happening on your screen. Great for any kind of software demo that you might want to do. So there's a link for that one. Everybody likes doing music production inside Studio 300. And there's a couple of really neat tools out there, and I've got some links to them. One of my favorites, actually, is this little online drum machine here. So let me get that rocking here. It's actually really neat, really kind of fun to program. Let's add a little crash cymbal in there. So you can just program in these different beats wherever you want to do it. Then you can even actually change the kits and get different sounds really fast here. More clave there. You can change the volume of the different parts. You can even change the pitches here a little bit. Let's get that snare a little higher. And the tempo. You can actually do a bunch of different ones, string them together into some patterns, and then by hitting the record button, it'll actually record this beat pattern, and then you can actually export that out to another program if you want to. I actually play guitar, and sometimes I like having a little drum beat going in the back room, in the background while I'm practicing. So I might program something really quick into this little program while I practice along on guitar. I'll spare you that for tonight, though. I definitely won't do that. Also, online piano, which I can actually play from the QWERTY keyboard of the Chromebook. Natural piano player, it's a little odd to play with the keyboard, but you get the idea. You can also use your mouse. Turn up that sustain. I actually play the letter notes on there too, so if you can learn those guys. What are all the apps? So that's available too as well. A little bit of fun there. Then there's also actually a piece of software. A lot of people like to use GarageBand or Logic Pro inside Studio 300. This little program here, Soundtrap, is actually really, really slick. So let me open up the studio portion of that. I've got to go get rid of the drum machine and the piano real fast. All right, give that a chance to load up. There we go. So this program actually allows you to record. It also comes with a series of different music loops and things like that that you can add. So here's a little song that I put together before I got started here today. So really just adding in some drums, some different beats, all those things are available here. So if you find that there's a specific one that you like, you can actually just drag that up and add that into a track there. I see, it didn't want me to add it where I added it before. So let's go ahead, we'll try it with that same song, but with a different beat. The idea. It's actually super powerful. There are some things that cost money, but then there are a lot of free things. So if you're just looking to experiment, play around, maybe play around with some ideas, come up with some other fun things, you can definitely do that too as well. There's synthesizers that could be added in, other patterns that you can do yourself, or all these little loops can be added and work. And then you can just share the song with other people, export it. Works out really, really nice. So another fun one there. Loop Labs is very similar to that. Beautiful Audio Editor is actually just a really, really basic audio editor. So you can actually just go in and get that running. You can add a page here, and we can actually just go into record really fast. And we'll go into record really quick, and I can put together something really, really fast. I can edit it, export it, use it for something else. And we'll actually record what I did there. And I can actually then go back and play that back, hopefully. Here, come on, stop. There we go. And we'll go into record really quick, and I can put together something really, really fast. I can edit it, export it, use it for something.
That sounded familiar, didn't it?
So that's Beautiful Audio Editor. Really simple, not quite as sophisticated as a sound trap that you saw a little bit earlier there. I'm not going to save that one. Related to music production would be audio production. A lot of people are interested in doing podcasting, and these are two online podcasting tools that you use. And I'm really, really keen on Zencastr, which is a really basic program. You can actually have somebody, many people actually, from anywhere in the world actually can then tune into the Zencastr here, and you can do all of the recording. It's really, really straightforward. I'm just going to create a little episode here. We'll call it 3, 4, 5, since the other one was called 1, 2, 3. And it doesn't really look like much at all, but it runs a little diagnostic check. And then you can invite other people. So if you wanted to do a true podcast where you're interviewing people in other parts of the world at any given point in time, you can bring them in. They'll all show up on here. And then you all just, once you hit record, it starts recording everybody speaking. It does record locally for everybody. So if somebody is in New Zealand and somebody is in Arizona, they just have to wait until the whole entire show is over. And usually a little bit longer after that ends, because it does save locally. And then it uploads it. And then you're allowed to bring all those elements down and produce your show. And it has all the tools you need for putting that together. It's really slick because you can mute people, you can raise your hand and really run it like a little tiny little radio station, and then take those finished podcasts and then put them on blogs, put them up on podcast aggregators, all of that. And Patrick in the studio has used this, and he's actually done a show on this, just specifically on how to use Zencastr, and he'd be happy to talk to you more about that. Let me know and we'll hook you up with that. Photo editing. So we looked at doing some different photo editing. Canva has a really good photo editor built into it here. And let me move around here. And Zoom is actually in my way, which is causing me problems there. There we go. So you can actually work right within Canva's own editor, which is actually really slick. But I'll be honest with you, the Canva one is really, really basic. And I actually like Pixlr a little bit more. And there's two different versions of that. One costs, one doesn't. Pixel X is the one that doesn't cost. So let's go ahead and just bring this one in here. Let's open up an image here real quick. I have out on my desktop here. What's the one do I want? And we'll use that one real quick. Here's one that I got from Unsplash here. And variety of different tools, and it looks actually deceptively simple here, but we can work really fast. So let's crop this one, just that simple that way. We can work on a variety of different color things. So we can warm things up, cool them off, bring out different elements, change the temperature. I'm just turning all kinds of sliders. You can really make it look really, really bad there, or really, really good. There are a variety of different filters also built in. Change the clarity. We can blur the image too as well. There are built-in filters. So if you just like a kind of a one-click thing that you want to do, you can do that. And it's nice as you can kind of back that back a little bit if you don't like all of that. I'll cancel out of that one. Also, one of my favorite kind of goof around tools, you can use Liquify on here. Let's make our brush a little bigger here. We can give this person really big eyes. If we like, we can also give them a really small nose too. So you can have a little fun with that. we'll just let that go. But actually, it's a really, really nice tool. You can add text, you can paint. Really, a lot of the same kinds of things that you would do in Photoshop are available right within this program. And then you can just save out the image, download it, and do whatever it is that you want to do moving forward. So really, really slick program. This is Pixlr back on the main list there too as well. Couple other ones there as well. In the 3D design, if you want to do some 3D printing, a Tinkercad, which we actually use in the studio. Here we are in the studio's account. Tinkercad actually uses really basic, what we call primitives. So you actually add just primitive bits and then you can kind of put them together and move things around and get an idea of how you might construct something. I don't know what I'm constructing, maybe some kind of spaceship or things like that. I am not a 3D designer, I'm the first to admit that. But this is actually a really nice tool. It's very simple, but I've seen some of the work that you can do in this with a little bit of perseverance and a little bit more 3D skill that I don't possess. And you can get some great results. This will, of course, output the files that you need to work on the Studio 300 3D printer. So if you've always wanted to do a little bit of design, you can go into Lynda and learn a little bit about Tinkercad and 3D design, and then come back and use a tool like this right on your Chromebook or the Chrome browser. So I definitely recommend that. Let me close a few things out here. Sorry about the two big eyes there on that model. So a little bit on video programming. I want to do a little video. There's a bunch of them out there, Animoto and Powtoons. And I really like Wii Video. I think it's really straightforward. It reminds me a little bit of iMovie. Very straightforward to use. There are some templates. You can also start from scratch here. So let me just, we'll start this template here on building a basic slideshow. And it has a variety of different tracks. So you can have your video and your audio separate. And all these things are editable, so you can just bring in any of your own artwork, add that stuff. You can change music if you want. So if you want a different music, they have a lot of built-in tunes, and so now we have a different piece of music instead. So what happens with Wii Video? There's really no traps. They do have certain pieces of stock media that they want to charge you for, but you can bring in your own video, you can bring in your own stills, your own graphics, you can bring in your own music and not have to pay for any of that. But whenever you output it, it is going to have this beautiful watermark on it. And as I said at the outset, kind of designed this for middle and high schoolers, and the teachers really didn't mind that the videos might be watermarked. You, of course, might not want yours watermarked. Unfortunately, you do have to pay for that. But if you're looking to just experiment and get an idea of how maybe a video editor works and how you might use it, you can do that obviously for free. But if you don't mind the watermarking, you can output that for free. But otherwise, you have to pay to have that removed. There we go. And let's see here, moving real quickly here since we're running out of time here, coding, if you're interested in learning coding, a whole bunch of different tools here too as well. One I really recommend is Hour of Code, which has just an amazing amount of coding activities. And what's really nice about this one is even though there's ones for really young grade schoolers, it actually does jump up for higher levels. And even at this level, you can get away from the object-oriented type of programming that it does in here and move actually into a more JavaScript-based here. So if you've always wanted to learn a bit of coding, this is a great introduction, even for adults, let alone youngsters. There's a lot of different levels and it really cements a lot of different ideas. Google actually does a lot of these little ones in the background. So like this animated name, you see the little Google logo here. This is a really guided piece that goes through every step that you need and explains all of the elements of it. It's a terrific way really to learn some coding, even though it does look a little young here when you're on there, but don't be afraid of it. You'd be surprised at how sophisticated some of the things can happen here if you're interested in coding. And last year, I just wanted to mention, if you're looking for a nice project management, a lot of people use things like Basecamp I can't think of any others right off the top of my head. But FreeCamp, as its name implies, is actually kind of a free version. I have just one that we've done before where you can kind of line up tasks, you can assign them to people, you can put things on a calendar. It's actually a really, really nice program. Works very similar to things like Basecamp and Slack. That was the one I was thinking of. So you can communicate with all the people on the team. You can assign teams. You can have other ways to do it. So if you're looking for some kind of project management, and it doesn't even necessarily have to be project management for a team. It could be just project management for you. And maybe you're working on a really large project, a home improvement project, and you want to keep track of all of the different steps. You can set this up and track all the work. So that's FreedCamp. I definitely recommend that. And last on my list here, really, two things. Chrome extensions. This doesn't work on the school Chromebooks, so I always put it on the bottom of this page. But if you have your own Chromebook, you can add a lot of these. These are just some of my favorites. Follow the links out there. I'm a real fan of Save to Google Keep, because I love to use Google Keep to capture things on the web, and I can just quickly click a button and it'll save those things for me. So there's a bunch of those. These are my favorites. Take a look and see if they'll work for you. And then I also like to mention a good security app. If you have a lot of passwords, rather than write them down, or worse, settling on really bad passwords or really simple passwords because they're easier to remember, consider something like LastPass, which allows you to generate one big password. You do a really sophisticated password, and then you can store all your other passwords for all your sites, whether that's banking or Google or anything like that. So take a look at something like that. It's a great way to secure all the things that you're doing, and it'll even help you through the different steps to make sure you're doing your best. And of course, we have a link to everything at Studio 300 too. So to get to all those wonderful links, remember this basic address, bit.ly/EVSD300. I appreciate you stopping by tonight. I know everybody's busy, and choosing something like this is, I really appreciate that.